Welcome back to RG Geek. Today we're here with...
Hi, I'm Russ from Retro Game Corps.
So, thanks Russ for coming out to Ludo. It's been a long trip from Hawaii.
Yeah, it's a long trip.
Yeah, we're to Halbe, Germany. This is right on the outskirts of Berlin. So, thank you so much. So, I was curious, what are some of your earliest gaming memories?
My first console was the NES, and we got that around 1985, 1986, so I was still really young. Before that, my dad had come home with an Atari 2600, and we hooked it up to our like kitchen TV. Like we had a regular TV and then a kitchen one, and it was on top of our fridge, and it was black and white. But it was a good fit, you know. And nice. So, I remember we had like a weekend with it. My dad had borrowed it from a coworker, and that was my first time playing games at home, and that was a big deal. You know, I always see games at arcades and stuff, and I'm like, oh, it's so cool, you know. But of course, 25 cents back then was like a lifetime's worth of money, and so
the original in-app purchase, right
exactly. Yeah, and so so that was a big deal. It was like being able to play games at home, no quarters required. You could just hit the button and you could play again, you know, and that was a big deal. So I have very early memories. I must have been kindergartner at that point. You know, and then maybe a year later we got the NES, and then things just took off from there.
So I think for me it was the opposite direction. Like I had the Atari at home, and then when we went to the arcade, that was like the, whoa, what are these graphics? This is so much better than what we have at home. But then you appreciate you go back home, you can still play the games even if they don't, even if they're downgraded versions of them.
Yeah, and that's the thing too, is like, I don't know if it was just like the rose-tinted like lens of being young, is sometimes like we just didn't notice that there was a difference between quality. So I remember like Ninja Turtles on arcade, it was so amazing looking. And then it came out on the NES, and we still thought it was amazing looking. And I swear, until like I had seen them side by side, I thought it was the same game.
Oh, wow.
Even though if you look at it today, it's like night and day difference, you know. But when you're 7, 8 years old, it still looks awesome.
It makes me wonder. Like, I wonder if my parents told me like that the quality is better than the arcade or something. Because I knew that from early on.
Right.
Like, I was well aware of it.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because I guess it's also different. My dad was more of a gamer, playing Pong and things like that, and my mom loved Pac-Man and Frogger. It's funny to have that background. So early.
That's so awesome.
Did your parents also game?
Not at all. There was a point where my dad, like, he was better than us. Very, very small window. So, like, we got Rad Racer for the NES, and he was the only guy who could, like, beat the first level. We couldn't, But, you know, a couple weeks later, we all had surpassed him. But for a while, you know, dad was king at NES, and then, he never caught up.
My dad kind of stopped gaming when it comes to the Super Nintendo, and I later asked him, like, why? And he's like, oh, yeah, the controls are just too complicated.
Oh, yeah.
It's too much. And I'm like, okay, I get that. Yeah, you played on my Super Nintendo in my teenage years. I have it upstairs here.
Yeah.
It's interesting, you go back and you feel like the D-pad of the old controller, and I was curious, but you've touched probably like hundreds of D-pads by this point, and I've coined the word with Shoryuken and all these words are now just commonplace in the retro gaming community. But I have to ask you the question, probably everyone's wondering, what's your favorite D-pad? Say, both handheld and controller.
Okay. So on a controller, it's surprising. Like I want to say NES just because I had so much familiarity with it, but when you go back and play it, it's such a hard D-pad. Like it's not very forgiving. After that, we had the Genesis. We didn't have the Super Nintendo, but playing that too just doesn't feel right for me anymore. I don't know what it is, but I think the Super Nintendo D-pad is my favorite.
Oh.
So it's got that good tactile kind of feel to it. There's a little mush to it, but not too bad. And it just works, you know. And even playing with yours yesterday, which is an older controller, obviously. It's been around for a while. The membranes are softer.
I think it's from the first year the Super Nintendo was out.
Yeah, it still plays great. I mean, we were playing Mario All-Stars.
Mario 3.
Yeah, and it behaved the way I expected it to behave. And that's exactly what I want, you know, with a Super Nintendo D-pad. So that's probably my favorite when it comes to a controller.
Okay.
And then for a handheld, I really do enjoy the PS Vita D-pad, you know?
Oh, nice.
And I would say that moving beyond that is like the Retroid and AYN wooden like D-pad, because it is very similar to the Vita one, but a little tighter. And so I like the tightness of it. So honestly, that's probably my favorite. It's probably not the... It's not the best out there, right? There are so many other good D-pads out there, but that's the one where it does all the things I want to. It's small, but not too small. And so it just kind of hits all those things that I want in a handheld.
Okay. I was thinking about that for myself, too. I was like, oh, how would I answer this question? And I thought, actually, I think the 8-bit 2 Pro 2 I like the best.
Yeah.
Because when I go back to the Super Nintendo, I don't like how it slides around a little bit. Like, it's authentic, obviously.
Yeah.
That's what it was made, but I was like, it doesn't feel right to me anymore.
It's got a little play to it, yeah.
Exactly. And same with the SNES Pro, Pro, all these stupid names from 8-bit 2. We actually have two in the other room. I even held one yesterday, but it's all the big deal. There's so much tech here. I'm exhausted, don't blame me. this is the last morning of Ludo on Monday.
I think it might be the Pro Plus. Is that sound right?
Oh, yeah, the Pro
Plus. Yeah, it might be that.
And I think I'd like the RG 350M, the best for the D-pad.
Okay.
Which is very solid, and that was my first, like, well, that's my second. I had the Dingo A320, but that really didn't feel like it was the modern era of retro handhelds. Okay. Life is weird, right? This is 2024. and I felt like ever since that, I've never had a D-pad I've liked as much as that one.
Yeah, it's a tactile D-pad, mm-hmm. Yeah. And I love the feel, that premium feel of pressing down, you touch the metal mm-hmm. with the handheld. You know, it gives a very premium feel.
Yeah, despite me not liking the metalness of that handheld, it's so heavy.
Yeah.
What was your most surprising experience or thing you've seen here, Ludo?
So I kind of knew what I was getting into coming mm-hmm. here, you know, just because I'd seen previous footage from you and stuff. Mm-hmm.
I should first say, Ludo's in a pretty small gaming event in a renovated train station here in Germany. So, there's other videos on my channel about that.
So I knew kind of going into it that it would be like different stations of gaming and like different, you know, I knew there was going to be a projector and stuff. The surprise to me was that how many 8-player games are available, like on Switch and stuff. And so we spent a lot of time doing that because it's just so inclusive, because everyone gets to play, or at least 8 people get to play.
It's also like how often you get 8 people together
right.
to play a game.
Yeah, and you don't think about that, especially in 2024 anymore. You just think about, does it have couch co-op, you know, 1 or 2 players, you know, you can play with your spouse or something.
Yeah.
But 8 players is a totally different game. It's fun, and it's so cool because many times, like, you know, Ludo's got advanced gamers and very beginning gamers and stuff, and sometimes those beginning gamers like did really well, you know, and would win and stuff. I mean, even our Mario Kart tournament, 2 of the 4 were just like very casual gamers, but the top people, you know, and so.
Yeah, I think the winner actually said she'd never played Mario 64, nor the Super Nintendo version.
Oh my gosh.
She took the whole thing.
Yeah.
First try.
Yeah.
Against all these experienced gamers. Yeah, I told him too, coming into this, I was like, you're going to meet people who have never heard of you and people who are mega fans. So this is an interesting mix of people here.
Yeah, it was really interesting.
Cool. Yeah, I think you said the game you liked the most on the 8-player was Virtual Racing.
Yeah, Virtual Racing is really fun. I wish there was more tracks to it. You know, there's only 3 tracks. But that's a fun one. And then, I don't know the name of it, but the one with the little boats, the ship.
Shipped,
that one was really fun. There was a lot of diversity there. And none of us knew how to play the game going into it, and so we figured it out as we were playing. Like, oh, this does that, or you push this button, it actually shoots. And so that was fun.
Yeah, for a while, it was just like little boxes on the screen, and we were just running over them. And only someone eventually said, oh, that shoots cannons out the side of my ship. And it changed everything. It was like, it's kind of fun just going to these, especially when you can play with lots of people who've never ever played the game before.
Right, yeah, totally.
Yeah, and I was joking, it's the Rhymes of the Wizard, the old game with the end of the Mario 3 game.
Right. It was
crazy. So thinking back to your channel, actually, I was curious, we can look up easily what your most viewed video is, and I actually don't know off the top of my head, but your viewers are seeing it right now on the screen. what was the video you most enjoyed making?
It's hard to pinpoint, you know. I can tell you the ones I least, like making the least, and that's like the videos about myself. So like making like Q&A videos.
So he's hating this video right now.
Yeah.
It's all Q&A. He's like, get me out of this room.
Right. Which is so funny for me to talk to a camera about myself, you know. Mm. But like the Q&A videos or a studio tour, things like that. I'm like, no one wants to know this stuff, you know. And so those are always like, I do them, but I like don't get excited about that, you know. But I'd say my favorite are going to be like the guides that are really in depth and comprehensive. So like my recent shaders video where I like went all in about like shaders and filters and overlays and stuff.
51 minutes even.
it's so long, almost an hour long. So that was really fun, just because
available in theaters nearby.
It's like, it's justification for all the time I spent learning all that stuff. Yeah. So I'm like, okay, I can brain dump this stuff. And so it's not all wasted. You know, like I didn't spend 3 weeks of my life learning this stuff just for myself, but I learned it for everyone else, you know?
And so, we remember our days where we'd never even know what shaders were.
Right.
Like, we heard shaders, and we're like, what does that even mean?
Yeah, exactly. And so, so that's always like cool to like kind of take that moment in time and the accomplishment of that. And then like my RetroArch video, you know, like just being like, okay, I figured out how to make this stuff work, even though the menu is so hard to navigate. Let me show you how I do it, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I like really making those videos a lot. I like the reviews and stuff too, but it's the guidance that really make me excited.
Very cool. So thank you for being here at the Esperanto Stazio, a small token of our appreciation to give you this cup.
Oh, that was great. Yeah, thank you. This has been a lot of fun, so it was cool.
You can drink for it and remember your time at Ludo, and we hope to have you back here sometime.
Thank you. So, thanks for having me.
All right. Like, subscribe, give us to your friends, and we'll see you next time on RG Geek.
You can beat the first level when you can, you know. And,
You just repeat so you can grab it.
So